Can you see my screen?
I can see the seven realities. Great. Avatar, Meher, Baba, Ki Jai. Existence, love, sacrifice, renunciation, knowledge, control, and surrender. I give no importance to creed, dogma, caste, or the performance of religious ceremonies and rites, but to the understanding of the following seven realities. The one, the only real existence is that of the one and only God, who is the self in every finite self. The only real love is the love for this infinity God, which arouses an intense longing to see, know, and become one with its truth, God. The only real sacrifice is that in which, in pursuance of this love, all things, body, mind, position, welfare, and even life itself are sacrificed. For the only real renunciation is that which abandons, even in the midst of worldly duties, all selfish thoughts and desires. Fifth, the only real knowledge is the knowledge that God is the inner dweller in good people and in so-called bad, in saint and in so-called sinner. This knowledge requires you to help all equally as circumstances demand, without expectation of reward, when compelled to take part in a dispute, to act without the slightest taste of enmity or hatred, to try to make others happy with brotherly or sisterly feeling for each one, and to harm no one in thought, word, or deed, not even those who harm you. Sixth, the only real control is the discipline of the senses to abstain from indulgence in low desires, which alone ensures absolute purity of character. Seventh, the only real surrender is that in which poise is undisturbed by any circumstance, and the individual amidst every kind of hardship is resigned with perfect calm to the will of God. Avatar, Meher, Baba, Ki Jai.
Thank you so much, and welcome back. We will continue from where we left off.
Yeah, I just want to add, Karthik, that the seventh of the seven realities is really very, I mean, that's what I'm thinking right now. If you want, you can just read it again. If you want, you can.
Sure. Go ahead.
The only real surrender is that in which poise is undisturbed by any circumstance, and the individual amidst every kind of hardship is resigned with perfect calm to the will of God. I think it's really, of course, all are important, and at the moment I am really connecting with this seventh reality. Jai Baba.
Very nice. Actually, I think I wanted to do an exercise to see the subtlety in difference between the three words: sacrifice, renunciation, and surrender. Surrender is, of course, clearly different, but these two are very close, right? Sacrifice and renunciation. So maybe there's some food for thought for all of us there. Yeah,
absolutely. Food for thought, some mental gymnastics.
These seven words are also akin to a step ladder, you know. Surrender becomes the ultimate aim to achieve. If you go to Meher Baba Center Pune, the steps in the front are,
yes,
there is written, you know, from bottom, from existence to surrender.
In fact, I've seen that in multiple centers. Kakinada, many places they have done the same thing.
Jai Baba.
Cool. Cool. So, Jai Baba, before we start, hey Kama, should we talk about that little conversation we had on immortality, if it's relevant, or we can pass that?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead. You explain it. It's something that he brought up, and I thought that was good to share with the group. Kama, go ahead.
Well, I think I was discussing with Karthik, about the fact that, you know, when we look at ourselves as human beings, when we are awake, we feel that we are immortal. That is, we are going to live forever. Even though we know that all of us have certain lifetimes, whether it's 40, 50, 60, 70, 84. So we all have, as they say in yoga, there are certain number of breathing cycles that each individual is designed for. So probably if you can increase your breathing cycle, you might live longer, but the breathing cycles is fixed, just like the 84 lakh lives, human lives. If you experience that, you are going to anyway emancipate. I mean, you are going to get nirvana or liberation, because every atma or soul is designed for liberation. That is the final goal. Why we have the guidance of a guru or avatar is to shorten the number of life cycles. So coming back to immortality, we all have this feeling inside ourselves that we are immortal, that we are going to live forever. But we know that people go through physical death, the gross body drops. And I was reading Rajneesh one day, quite a number of years ago. And I also asked this question, what is this feeling that I'm being immortal? And he gave this answer that it is the self, the soul self, the Atma, the soul doesn't die, right? So that soul self in each one of us gives us that feeling of immortality. But what really dies is the physical death of the body, and the body, gross body, is changing all the time. And we know that from Baba's literature, that the human body or human being is divided into two, the material body, which is the gross, subtle, and mental body. And then you have the spiritual body. The spiritual body is your Atma with its pure consciousness. Now, this drop soul Atma has gone through from the Big Bang on the most original whim through evolution of the seven kingdoms, and we have reached the human state, which Baba says we have full and complete consciousness, which means technically all human beings are God realized, but not awakened to their divinity because of sanskaras. So the conclusion here is that we are all immortal because the self is immortal, because it is existence, eternal, infinite existence, which is what Baba says in God Speaks. So that was the discussion we had. Jai Baba. Any questions or comments?
One comment. This immortality is not in the mortal. That's what we have to realize.
Perfect. I mean, the thought is correct. The concept is correct. We attribute it to the wrong thing. That is what was very interesting. Discovery I had, and I've been reflecting on that since the time we had that chat, and I thought it was worthy of being shared with the group. Any other comments or questions around that?
Yeah, I just want to add that I've been reading Listen Humanity last 1 week, and part two, which is the subsection Life and the Path, and the first chapter is Death and immortality. Of course, it's an extension, as Kama has rightly put it, that it's the second part of Discourses, or it can be said it's a beautiful chapter. Of course, it takes around 1 hour to absorb it, because it's got a lot of comparison with our lives, and how, and it says that what is life, what is death. I would request everyone to read it. I have, of course, read it, but I think if we have time, I'll read later on maybe some of the parts.
Sure, feel free to share snapshots or the text or the references on the group as well on Telegram.
Okay. So shall I read just one line, which is very important?
Sure, of course.
It's on page 97. It says, for the sanskaras, it's with respect to sanskaras, in order to be wiped out in toto, sanskaras must be annulled or cancelled through the process of exact equalization of perfect qualitative and quantitative balancing of all opposite sanskaras, whether good or bad. This is extremely difficult, for the sanskaras have a natural tendency towards preponderance of one opposite over the other. I mean, the whole thing, but there's one line which I have not understood, and I'm opening this question to the entire group. On page 96, it says, instead of looking upon death as the opposite of life, he now inherently comes to look upon it as the handmaiden of life. This is something very intriguing. I could not understand. If somebody can throw some light. Yeah, this is it. Yeah, you got it right. Very nice. Yeah, very fast. You know, I would request all to read this. Of course, I read it with the present situation, but it's really very, very profound and apt. And a lot of things are explained in this.
See, Jai Baba, life and death are just two sides of the same coin. Instead of life and death, we can say birth and death. And as Baba says in God Speaks, the real birth is the birth of the mind. And the real death is the manunash, the death of the mind. Because the Atma soul doesn't have a mind before the whim. The whim, who am I, creates the first impression. That first impression or sanskara needed to be experienced by the infinite unconsciousness of the soul, state 2A. That basically created this whole evolution process, starting from the most basic, you know, quarks or whatever you call it. And as Baba says, all the births and deaths that we have in our human form are just the same aspect of the sleeps that we have every day. So an analogy is that every day we get up, it's creation. We are now awake, we are doing our activities, that preservation. We go to sleep, that is dissolution. So if that is extrapolated to the birth and death of a human gross form, that is, you're born as a male or a female, you're born, you go through the birth, school, work, death process, you live till 84, you drop your body, again take a different human form, male or female, based on depending on sanskaras, till the mind becomes zero, which means sanskaras become zero, there is no more ego, and then you get liberated. So that is the real definition of birth and death. Birth is the most original whim, where the mind is created, and then the real death is the death of the mind, because you go back to your own self, the union with God or the realized self. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, thank you for those comments. Any other questions or thoughts on this? Yeah, maybe we should take up reading this after discourses or whenever is the right time. But yeah, thanks for sharing, Ashok.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So the imperfect ones, we are reading perfection, or maybe I'm being very confident that all of us are imperfect. So we are reading perfection. We were midway through that. So we understood the two types of perfection, and we understood excellence versus perfection. And we understood only in duality, it's only relative perfection, whereas real perfection in spiritual perfection is different. We also understood the difference between spiritual perfection and excellence. Then the key line here was the different types of excellence that are characteristic of duality are all within the scope of the intellect. So what is the spiritual perfection is beyond intellect. The perfection that belongs to the spiritually realized souls is not in the domain of duality, and as such is entirely beyond the scope of the intellect. His perfection consists in the knowledge of the one indivisible existence. Right. So with that, then we went on to understand all forms of excellence in spiritual perfections. That is, a spiritually perfect one also has all the material excellence that we count as material perfection or material excellence. Then we were at the perfection must be all-sided. So let's start with perfection includes opposites. Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai. Perfection includes opposites. If you try to grasp the nature of perfection by means of a set standard implying an opposite, you are bound to limit it and thus fail to understand its real significance. Perfection includes the opposites and transcends them. Therefore, a perfect one is not bound by any rule or limited ideal. He is beyond good and bad. But his law for those who are good provides good rewards, and for those who are bad, it responds in their own coin. Krishna proved to Arjuna, who was his devotee, that his apparent bringing about of the physical and mental annihilation of the vicious Kauravas was for their spiritual salvation. Perfection might manifest itself through killing or saving according to the spiritual demands of the situation. The heart of a perfect one is at once as soft as butter and as hard as steel. Perfection is not limited in its expression to any one of the opposites and does not exclude the possibility of finding the expression through the opposite. Let me read that line again. Perfection is not limited in its expression to any one of the opposites and does not exclude the possibility of finding expression through the opposite. So if you take it as a gradient, it encompasses both the ends as well. So if there is a graph or a line, you're basically taking all of it. That is perfection. That is why perfection transcends the opposites and is capable of giving a rational response to all the possible situations in life. It ensures perfect adaptability without surrendering the standpoint of truth and secures an unshakable peace and sense of harmony in the midst of diverse situations, which must be baffling to those who have not achieved all-sided development. Full development of human rationality. Human activities are limited by the opposites, and perfection is beyond them. It should not be imagined, however, that perfection has no human element about it. When human beings are unhappy, they laugh to make themselves and others happy. But even a perfect one who is eternally happy is not without a sense of humor. In other words, perfection does not consist in being inhuman, but superhuman. It is the full development of that rationality which is implicit in humanity. Perfection is man becoming God or God becoming man. Perfection does not belong to God as God, nor does it belong to man as man. Perfection is attained when man becomes God or when God becomes man. The finite being who is conscious of his being finite is obviously short of perfection. But when he is conscious of being one with the infinite, he is perfect. That is what happens when man gives up the illusion of being finite and attains godhood by realizing his divinity. If by the infinite one means that which is opposed to the finite or is separate from the finite and necessarily other than the finite, this infinite is already limited by its being unable to assert itself in and through the finite. In other words, perfection cannot belong to such an infinite. I will read this part again. That is what happens. I'll start from here. That is what happens when man gives up the illusion of being finite and attains godhood by realizing his divinity. If by the infinite, one means that which is opposed to the finite or is separate from the finite and necessarily other than the finite, this infinite is already limited by its being unable to assert itself in and through the finite. In other words, perfection cannot belong to such an infinite. The infinite, therefore, has to discover its unlimited life in and through the finite without getting limited by this process. It's a very, very important takeaway.
This whole paragraph is very, very
profound.
Say, concise and profound theory of what Baba postulates completely. So the one aspect what we'll have to remember is everything contains nothing. That is the dictum. So that is what is referred to here. So finite is a part of the infinite. Infinite cannot say it is infinite unless it is able to take in the finite also into its consideration. So the whole paragraph is the sort of an epitome of what all we have learned of Baba's definition regarding finite and infinite and the inclusion of nothing and nothingness in everything.
Yeah.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, actually, I think there is a mention elsewhere in discourses that the infinite with the capital I is beyond duality. So it is not just the opposite of finite. In fact, finite and infinite for the mortals is different from the infinite which is mentioned here, which is much way beyond duality. I'm just highlighting it.
Perfect. So the point that's being made and which is the core message is infinite is not limited or not to be understood by being related or bigger than finite. It's, you know, that's the key takeaway. But yeah, this is very, very important. And I totally agree with Mama saying this is a summary and a core message of everything. Yeah. And that's a good point. Everything and the nothing. Yeah. So I'll continue. God's perfection is
Kartik, I have a note here. Yeah. I don't know how I wrote this. I am perfect. When we say in duality in routine conversation, I am perfect. So if you split that, I am, to remove that, then you will become perfect. Otherwise, you are not perfect. The sense of I am. If you remove that, you will really become perfect.
Correct.
Jai Baba.
Correct. Then few of us can even say that in the material plane, saying I am perfect. So we are far from that.
Yeah.
We'll take the long, long road. That works for, I mean, your point works for people who are able to say, I am perfect.
Yes.
Even in the material world. Okay, I'll continue. God's perfection is revealed only when he manifests himself as man. The conscious descent of God into the limited form of man is the avatar. This again is a case of perfection. Thus, we have perfection when the finite transcends its limits and realizes its infinity, or when the infinite gives up its supposed aloofness and becomes man. This is again a very interesting line. Thus, we have perfection when the finite transcends its limits and realizes its infinity, which is the journey, or when the infinite gives up its supposed aloofness and becomes man. In both cases, the finite and the infinite do not stand outside each other. When there is a happy and a conscious blending of the finite and the infinite, we have perfection. Then we have the infinite revealing itself through the finite without getting limited, thereby, and the finite transcending its sense of limitation in the full knowledge of its really being the revelation of the infinite. So that is the end of perfection.
And this paragraph gives an importance to the descent of avatar.
Avatar.
Yes. Because that is the blending of finite with infinite.
Infinite.
And the expression of infinite through finite.
Correct. Any questions, comments from the group?
Yeah, Karthik, the last line, can somebody explain that?
I will read it again and then we can open it up for discussion. Then we have the infinite revealing itself through the finite without getting limited thereby, and the finite transcending its sense of limitation in the full knowledge of its really being the revelation of the infinite. So it's he's referring to the blending, if I can attempt explanation. He's referring to the blending where both are moving, right? So the infinite reveals itself through the finite. At that point, it's not limited by the finiteness of the finite. And the finite is actually transcending its sense of limitation and becoming infinite with the knowledge.
Can I have one view on this? So the first part of the sentence refers to an avatar, and the second part refers to a Sadguru. Can we take it like that also? Well, if we can read once again and identify.
Yeah.
The infinite limit.
I agree with your point in a limited sense, but then we have to see this sentence in totality, and he's talking more of the blending. So if you take it up from the sentence starting here, in both cases, the finite and the infinite do not stand outside each other. When there is a happy and conscious blending of the finite and the infinite, we have perfection. What are the two instances? I mean, not two instances, the two blendings that are happening. One is the infinite revealing itself through the finite without getting limited thereby, and the finite transcending its sense of limitation in the full knowledge of its really being the revelation of the infinite. So one could be the journey up to perfect master, the second one. The first one is, as you said, the manifestation of the avatar.
Yeah. So these things make you think so much that you can put different perspectives to understand the essence of what is written by Baba or told by Baba.
Indeed, indeed.
Or showed on the board by Baba, or showed by the his movements of hands and expression by Baba.
So Jai Baba, I think the way I interpret it is we have the infinite revealing itself through the finite. So I think that was correct interpretation about the avatar, or you can go a little further and say the eternal avataric infinite consciousness revealing itself through the finite, which means being born as an avatar without getting limited thereby, because he's got Vijnanis. Somebody has to mute, please. Okay. So I think that, you know, so the basic idea here is the eternal avataric infinite consciousness, which is the first revelation
of the avatar, which goes, which stems from the first human soul who become God realized. And then again and again, when the avatar is asked to descend, what we call as the advent of the avatar by the five perfect masters, in each cycle of 700 to 1400 years, the infinite, where the eternal avataric infinite consciousness in the form of the avatar is asked to come down through the finite by being born because he's veiled, but he's not limited because he doesn't have prarabdha sanskaras, which we discussed about last time, that he comes with vijnani sanskaras, which are veiled, and then he starts with the yoga sanskaras when he awaken, when he is unveiled by the five perfect masters or by the guru. And then when it says the finite transcending its sense of limitation in the full knowledge, which is again the infinite unconsciousness, state 2A, all of us who are drop souls, jivatmas, going through evolution, reincarnation, involution, and we are finite, transcending our limitation and ascending to the seventh plane with the full knowledge of its really being the revelation of the infinite. So it applies to everybody, whether it's a Sadguru or the 56 God realized souls, or, you know, all the people who get Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Jai Baba.
Yes, that's why I said any one of us can become a Sadguru also. Jai Baba.
Can you elaborate on that? I don't understand what you're trying to say here.
No, say any one of us or all of us can become Sadguru means we are in the path and we can go through the path. You need not stop at any stage. You can go the full distance and then become say the seventh plane, before the seventh plane or beyond the seventh plane is achievable by anyone. That's what I was referring to last time also when I said when Kama said he is happy with mukti, I said I would like to go through further and become a Sadguru. So that's what he is referring to. That once again, every finite self can achieve the ultimate, that is referred to in the second part of the sentence here. Hey Baba.
Agreed. Me and Kama have a new acronym. So just as you're saying your aspiration is to go to perfect master, we have a new goal. We have set, at least I have a new goal. It's MOM, minimum ordinary mukti.
He wants to be mom.
Mom, yeah. M-O-M.
Okay.
Ordinary.
See, to add on to what Doc Mama said, if you look at God Speaks, page 148, I'll just read this. In human form, the highest and the most exalted divine status of God is that of Kutubiyat, where the Kutub or the Sadguru or perfect master not only consciously experiences infinite knowledge, power, and bliss, and all goodness, and all that is infinite beauty, meaning glory, but he consciously uses this infinite aspects for those jivatmas still undergoing the illusory states of God in illusion. So we are all undergoing the illusory states of God in illusion. You know, Baba in God Speaks actually refers to all the jivatmas, all the souls, human souls, as God in illusion. In this exalted divine status of Kutubiyat, not only man becomes God, but man lives the life of God too. To worship this man God, which is MG, not GM, not God man. God man is avatar, man God is Sadguru. Is to worship God. To worship this man God is to worship God with infinite attributes. This highest divine status of living the life of God consciously in human form is attained very, very rarely by very, very few Shivatmas after the unconscious atmas pass through the process of evolution, reincarnation, and involution of consciousness as jivatmas and attain nirvana, MOM, which in some cases is immediately followed by nirvikalpa samadhi of super consciousness asserting as shivatmas. So again, I read this. This should be impressed in our mind. This highest divine status of living the life of God as Kutub, consciously in human form, is attained very, very rarely by very, very few shivatmas after the unconscious atmas pass through the process of evolution, reincarnation, and involution of consciousness as jivatmas and attain nirvana, which in some cases is immediately followed by nirvikalpa samadhi of super consciousness asserting as shivatmas. Jai Baba.
Super. Awesome reference.
Yes, immediate reference.
Okay, so we go back to the next chapter. Any other points before we continue? Folks, others are very silent this morning.
They are very sad that they can only think of MOM, their mom. You know, mom, another thing. Karthik, that was good. MOM.
Yeah.
Minimum, what is that? Minimum operating?
Minimum ordinary mukti.
Ordinary mukti. Yes. Ordinary mukti is defined as moksha, which is what my dad keeps saying. He's 92 years old. And keeps cribbing and complaining when he's going to get moksha. But I keep telling him, like, you know, you have to start transforming from God-fearing to God-loving. Because actually, Baba says in God Speaks that God-fearing people who follow all the laws will get moksha after they drop their body. You know, that is one of the conditions. But Rajneesh also said one thing, that self-realization is like winning the lottery. You know, so the only thing you can do is, I have an analogy that I use, that if you have to win the lottery, you have to buy the lottery ticket. So to buy the lottery ticket, you need money. To earn money, you need a skill. To have a skill, you need to practice. So the ball game of self-realization also is about intense effort. You have to keep doing that IEIP, intense effort and infinite patience. Now we have Baba as the guide. So we don't have to worry when the lottery will happen or what kind of lottery will happen, whether nirvana, ordinary moksha, nirvikalpa samadhi, or sahaja samadhi, or any of the 56 God-realized beings. So the Baba keeps saying that, you know, we have to enjoy life. Play the ball game of life according to the laws of nature, which we have read in the beams. Not just the material laws, but the supernatural laws, the law of karma and the law of divine grace. And it will happen by the grace of God, you know, by the grace of the Guru, whenever the lottery of self-realization or nirvana, whenever it happens. Jai Baba.
Thank you very, 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 very much. There are four berries.
Yes, yes, yes. And also, say, in between the four, very, very, there is a rarely also.
Yes, additionally. I'm not demotivating you.
See, it is not Doc Mama's fault. Doc Mama is a professor. He's a tenured professor who like to be chairman emeritus if possible. But that, I think, in the spiritual world, he can be chairman emeritus of his university. But in the spiritual world, chairman emeritus avatar role is taken up. Nobody can replace that. So the highest he can reach for is Sadhguru, which is not, I think his wish could become fulfilled. You know, Baba basically gives the wish of everybody. He will fulfill, like, you know. Jai Baba.
Correct. See, and there is an aspect to the perfect master which not everybody may identify with, right? So he's post reaching the stage of infinite, right? There's a lot of work. So that's an aspect that not everybody will get excited by.
Yeah, you need to be a tenured professor for that. And Doc Mama is perfect.
Exactly. He's on his way.
Hope so.
So with the best wishes,
I said hope so. That's all.
So yeah, we shall all pray for Doc Mama to become a Sadhguru as part of apart from our own emancipation. We will ask Baba that we would like you to help Doc Mama to become a Sadhguru, not just one of the 56, you know. Hey Baba.
Sure. With best wishes towards the end.
And we can use that for branding the group, you know, MBA. Jai Baba. This is the way.
Corporate touch is there from Sanjay G, as always. So, with that, let's get on to the next chapter if there are no more questions. I think there are none. So we start with life of the spirit. Physical page number is 83. True Karma Yoga. What's going on? Yeah. Yeah, in true Karma Yoga, or the life of perfect action, there is proper adjustment between the material and the spiritual aspects of life. In this type of life, consciousness is not fettered by mundane and material things, but at the same time, it is not allowed to run away from everyday existence. The mind is not allowed to be immersed in the material life of gnawing wants, nor is it allowed to be merged in spiritual bliss. It is used to face and tackle the problems of life from the point of view of spiritual understanding. Matter as a pliable instrument for expression of spirit. Proper adjustment between the material and the spiritual aspects of life is not secured by giving equal importance to them. It is not secured by taking something from the material and something from the spiritual and then striking a balance between the two. The spirit must and ever will have an inviolable primacy over matter. However, the primacy is not expressed by avoiding or rejecting matter, but rather by using it as an adequate vehicle for the expressions of the spirit. So this is a very important concept brought out here. So in intelligent adjustment, matter has to play the role of a pliable instrument for the self-manifestation of the spirit and must not in any way become obtrusive in its own right. Just as a musical instrument is valuable only if it gives expression to the song of a musician and becomes a hindrance if it does not yield complete subservience, matter is valuable if it gives free and adequate expression to the creative flow of life and becomes an obstacle if it interferes with it. So beautiful analogy and definitive assertion of the primacy of spirit over matter. And I think that analogy of the instrument is also very, very useful. Spirituality requires subordination of matter, not rejection. owing to the multifarious cravings of the mind, matter has a tendency to assume importance for itself. For the drunkard, wine is everything. For the greedy, the hoarding of money is all important. And for the flirt, the chase of sensations is the supreme end of life. These are examples of how, through diverse cravings of the mind, matter becomes unduly obtrusive and perverts the expression of the spirit. The way to restore the dignity of the spirit is not to reject matter, but to use it for the claims of the spirit. This is possible only when the spirit is free from all cravings and is fully conscious of its own true status. When this is achieved, an individual may have material goods, but is not caught up in them. When necessary, he may use them as means for the life of the spirit, but he is not allured by them, nor does he become restless for them. He realizes that in themselves, they do not constitute the real significance of life. He dwells in the material and social environment without any hankering for them, and being unattached, is able to convert them into spiritual life. Freedom of spirit expressed through dominion over matter. When one's true adjustment between spirit and matter is secured, there is no phase of life that cannot be utilized for the expression of divinity. No longer is there any need to run away from everyday life and its tangles. The freedom of the spirit that is sought by avoiding contact with the world and retiring to a cave or to the mountains is a negative freedom. When such retirement is temporary and is meant to digest worldly experiences and develop detachment, it has its own advantages. It gives breathing time in the race of life. But when such retirement is grounded in fear of the world or lack of confidence in the spirit, it is far from helpful in the attainment of real freedom. Real freedom is essentially positive and must express itself through unhampered dominion of the spirit over matter. This is the true life of the spirit. Spirituality covers the whole of life. The life of the spirit is expression of infinity and as such knows no artificial limits. True spirituality is not to be mistaken for an exclusive enthusiasm for some fad. It is not concerned with any ism. When people seek spirituality apart from life, as if it had nothing to do with the material world, their search is futile. All creeds and cults have a tendency to emphasize some fragmentary aspect of life, but true spirituality is total in its outlook. The essence of spirituality does not consist in a specialized or narrow interest in some imagined part of life, but in a certain enlightened attitude to all the various situations that obtain in life. It covers and includes the whole of life. All the material things of this world can be made subservient to the divine gain. And when they are thus subordinated, they become auxiliary to the self-affirmation of the spirit. Body, not necessarily hindrance to spiritual life. The value of material things depends upon the part they play in the life of the spirit. In themselves, they are neither good nor bad. They become good or bad according to whether they help or hinder the manifestation of divinity through them. Take, for example, the place of the physical body in the life of the spirit. It is a mistake to set up an antithesis between flesh and spirit. Such contrast almost inevitably ends in an unqualified condemnation of the body. The body obstructs spiritual fulfillment only if it is pampered as having claims in its own right. Its proper function is rightly understood as ancillary to spiritual purposes. The rider needs a horse if he is to fight a battle, though the horse can become an impediment if it refuses to be completely submissive to his will. In the same way, the spirit needs to be clothed in matter if it is to come into full possession of its own possibilities, although the body can at times become a hindrance if it refuses to be compliant with the requirements of the spirit. If the body yields to the claims of the spirit as it should, it is instrumental in bringing down the kingdom of heaven on earth. It becomes a vehicle for the release of divine life, and when it subserves this purpose, it might aptly be called the temple of God on earth. Since the physical body and other material things
Karthik, can you repeat the paragraph and keep in mind the avatar? So all of you just think of avatar and read this paragraph.
Okay. The rider needs a horse if he is to fight a battle, though the horse can become an impediment if it refuses to be completely submissive to his will. In the same way, the spirit needs to be clothed in matter if it is to come into full possession of its own possibilities, although the body can at times become a hindrance if it refuses to be compliant with the requirements of the spirit. If the body yields to the claims of the spirit as it should, it is instrumental in bringing down the kingdom of heaven on earth. It becomes a vehicle for the release of divine life, and when it subserves this purpose, it might aptly be called the temple of God on earth. I'm not able to relate this to the avatar.
Not able to. Okay.
Yeah.
No, actually, is infinite, but
yeah.
It comes into the finite world for the benefit of all the other, souls in duality. So it clothes itself in the body and uses the body for this purpose. So that is also partly told about here. So that's why it becomes a temple of God on earth. So the body of Baba or the manifestation in the human form of God itself is avatar, and Baba was the avatar, and this physical body of Baba was used for the work of the infinite. So this all came to my mind when I read this paragraph. Jai Baba.
I think the interpretation I have when you say it called the temple of God on earth refers to the body. That is why we have the saying. Yeah. So we have the saying that the body is the temple of the soul. Okay. Which means that you have to take care of your physical body. You have to take care of your mental body. That is why we have the practice of Hatha Yoga. And then that is for the physical body. Then you have the practice of Kriya Yoga, which is for the subtle body, because it has to do with the chakras and the 72,000 meridians in the body. Then you have the practice of Vipassana, which has to do with the mental body. If the gross body is not fit, then we don't have the ability to progress in our spiritual journey. Of course, there are exceptions like Dr. Stephen Hawking, he had a physiological issue, but he was mentally very strong, they said his three secretaries could not keep up with his energy. Now, that is a very extraordinary circumstance.
So I have heard about this part, you know, body is the temple of the soul, and I used to wonder what it means. And also the other insight I have is that, see, we should not confuse avatar and God. God is existence, infinite, eternal existence from the seven realities. He is truth, is divine love, is infinity, and so on and so forth, self-consciousness and all that. Avatar definition is God in human form, which is correct. You need a body. But I think in the aspect of God, see, whenever we say Baba, you know, today I was thinking, you know, why not say Baba, our innermost loving self? God, our innermost loving self. When we keep saying Baba or God or Buddha, we are objectifying God as a separate entity than ourselves and kind of stuck in the sixth plane. Why not just be in the seventh plane and say, hey, whenever we are talking about God, subliminally, we should have mentally inside ourselves, God, our innermost loving self. So whenever I hear the Parvardigar prayer, when Baba says, you are in the firmament, you are in the depths, I interpret it as your innermost loving self. Sure. Is addressing ourselves. So I think in that regard, you know, that consciousness from the Big Bang needs a body to self-emancipate on planet Earth, because only in human form you can have nirvana or nirvikalpa samadhi. So body needs consciousness to sustain itself, and consciousness also requires the human body to self-emancipate. Jai Baba.
Thank you.
Awesome explanation. So let's all fake it till we make it. Keep saying Baba, our innermost loving selves. Fake the seventh plane till you make it.
Okay.
Since the physical, I'll continue. Since the physical body and other material things can be used for the life of the spirit. I have an interruption, and I just remembered one more thing. So to continue what Kama just said, the human body is also the temple of the soul because of the journey of evolution, right? So it's the only form that can lead to further progress, and it has reached here through evolution of the form as well. So in that sense, it is the pinnacle of physiological evolution of form, and hence is the temple of the soul, temple of God basically. So that's another aspect God speaks covers very beautifully, saying all of creation is only geared to moving the evolution of form to its pinnacle, so that the evolution of that form can be used where consciousness can realize, right? So that's another thought that came to mind.
Another comment, Jai Baba. The sure. Chapter, Life of the Spirit, and if you look at the chapter on perfection, where perfection is divided into material perfection and spiritual perfection, and since we live in a very scientific world, technology world today, I think this chapter on life of the spirit is also telling us how to balance our material life and spiritual life. So one of the things I have in my presentation is health is wealth and wealth is health. Physical health, mental health, and material wealth. You need all three. These three are mandatory. You know, so it is not just physical and mental health, but also you need rokda, you know, that is important, material wealth. Just like you need this human body or human form to self-emancipate, similarly for our practical day-to-day life, you need to become financially secure, material wealth. So the other thing is also you can have all three, but do you have the time to self-emancipate? Now, also, most people don't even bother about self-emancipation. They have all three and time, but they don't know what to do with themselves. So either you have a Bill Gates trying to, you know, patent this, whatever that is, or you have a Rajat Gupta wanting to go from a multimillionaire to a billionaire's club. So that is an interesting aspect of this Maslow's hierarchy of self-esteem. You know, the second last aspect of the Maslow's hierarchy, where the topmost pyramid is self-actualization, which to me is self-realization, actually. So I think that is where I feel this chapter is very important. The life of the spirit is also about the life of balancing matter and spirit. Jai Baba.
Absolutely. I was reminded of your frequently used phrase multiple times, but I have a suggestion, Kama. I think when I was reading this paragraph, right, when one's true adjustment between spirit and matter is secured, there's no phase of life that cannot be utilized for the expression of divinity. I think in place of balancing, I think adjustment is the better word. And I think we briefly talked about this in the past. Balancing is unfair because dominion of spirit is over matter and primacy of spirit is over matter. So adjustment is a better word, is all my suggestion, is all a suggestion.
Very well said. I think you're fine tuning my presentation. Thanks. I like inputs like that. Jai Baba.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll continue. Since the last paragraph on 85, since the physical body and other material things can be used for the life of the spirit, true spirituality does not take any hostile attitude towards them, but seeks expression in and through them. Thus, a perfected person does not look down upon things of beauty or works of art, attainments of science, or achievements of politics. Things of beauty can be degraded by being made objects of craving or jealous and exclusive possessiveness. Works of art can often be used to augment and exploit egoism and other human frailties. The attainments of science can be used for mutual destruction, as in modern wars. Political enthusiasm without spiritual insight can perpetuate social and international chaos. But all these can also be rightly handled and spiritualized. Things of beauty can become the source of purity, happiness, and inspiration. Works of art can ennoble and raise the consciousness of people. The attainments of science can redeem humanity from unnecessary suffering and handicaps. Political action can be instrumental in establishing a real brotherhood of humanity. The life of the spirit does not consist in turning away from worldly spheres of existence, but in reclaiming them for the divine purpose, which is to bring love, peace, happiness, beauty, and spiritual perfection within the reach of everyone. This section has the subtitle, Science, Art, Politics Can Serve Spiritual Ends. And each of those are explained. Science, art, politics. Detachment does not...
Hold on one second. I think this paragraph is very important. Science, art, politics can serve spiritual ends. Because I'll give you some example. Today I was reading The Guardian. And this line on page 86, second line, works of art can often be used to augment and exploit egoism and other human frailties. Now, when you look at works of art, you can also look at it like, suppose you are a producer, director, actor. In England, there was this BAFTA Awards, B-A-F-T-A. You know, I'll send that link later. I'll just quickly, it's just a case study. I think it's an African-American guy, not American, I should say, probably because he's born and brought up in English. He's got a 20-year track record of doing very good, you know, movies and TV shows and all that stuff. And recently, about 20 people came and accused him of sexual harassment, you know, and the BAFTA award is very prestigious, you know. So, you know, they were basically saying that he was using his power to exploit, you know, to deal with his own fantasies. So this is one example of how you can be perfect in your art, but you can use that to exploit, you know, because of your ego. So I'll send that link to you. The other part is also, you know, where here it says things of beauty can be degraded by being made objects of craving or jealous and exclusive possessiveness and works of art. Now, I've noticed on Wall Street, you know, there are a lot of these hedge fund managers. You know, there was one guy, I forget his name, you know, there's a huge book on him also, very talented guy. Now, these hedge fund managers make so much money, you know, they go from multimillionaires to become billionaires. So a lot of the money goes to buying art because they have everything. So what has happened is, if you look at the Sotheby's and the art auction houses, some of these art paintings go for $100, $200, $300 million, you know. And this is an example of this degraded, the arts of beauty can be degraded by being made objects of craving or jealous and exclusive possessiveness. And recently I read how the Germans have decided to give back Nigeria some of their most important art, you know, which was stolen during the imperial, you know, when Germany was probably losing parts of Africa. And during World War II, the Brits, of course, have stolen a lot of art from India. We know that all over the museums, all over the world, even in Britain, we see this art stolen from the country of origin. They technically should be giving it back, you know. So this is a good example, you know, that science, art, politics can serve spiritual ends. And I think it reminds me the best Sadhguru to look at is King Janaka, who was not only, a Sadhguru, but was a king. And one Sadhguru that we know about is Narayan Maharaj. So I don't want to go into it, but Narayan Maharaj lived in sort of a luxury, royal, you know, his throne was silver. But he had definitely a purpose behind that. Jai Baba.
Great. Yes, nice. Thank input. You. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'll continue. Detachment does not mean indifference. However, those who would live the life of the spirit must remain detached in the midst of worldly things, without becoming cold or indifferent to them. Detachment should not be misunderstood as lack of appreciation. It is not only compatible with the true evaluation of things, but is its very condition. Craving creates delusion and prevents right perception. It nourishes obsessions and sustains the feeling of dependence upon external objects. Detachment promotes right understanding and facilitates perception of the true worth of things without making consciousness dependent upon external objects. To see things as they
This last sentence, very nice definition of craving and detachment.
Yes.
One more thing I want to comment here is that the difference between detachment and indifference. Now, a lot of people, you know, we have noticed that people who seem to be detached, sometimes we interpret them as to be indifferent and cold-blooded. Whereas people who seem to be indifferent or cold-blooded, we interpret them as being detached. So this is a very important, you know, paragraph where it's the subtitle says detachment does not mean indifference. I'll give an example for myself. You know, I was very close to my mother's younger sister, my aunt, who was like almost looked like a Bollywood movie star, you know, and I was very attached to her. You know, we had a very soul relationship, and she dropped her body in her mid-40s, you know, and I somehow did not feel anything, you know. It was for a very long time, I was very guilty that I did not feel any form of sorrow or suffering, because I kind of accepted the fact that she had dropped her body, her time had come. And when I used to tell this to other people, I would be told that, oh, you got to cry, you got to show your emotion. But looking back, I realized that I have this latent tendency of being detached in certain situations, you know. So that is just an example, Jai Baba.
You're sure it's detachment, no? Not indifference.
No, it is detachment because...
I'm just kidding.
You're right. Because I went through my mom's own cancer thing and all that. Because I think all of us as human beings, because of our sanskaras, have certain attributes which we are not able to explain when we are very young. But thanks to Baba and understanding the spiritual knowledge that he has given us, we can understand these different, very minute, finer details of what is indifference and what is detachment. Jai Baba.
Thanks for pointing that out and also sharing that example. Thank you very much. Oh, there's that second doc showing up after a break. How are you? Houston signing in.
Peoria, small town Peoria, village.
No, I said Houston, can you hear me? I thought you went to Houston, right? Yeah.
Houston, we have a problem. Yes.
Yes.
So glad to be back.
Yeah, glad to have you back. I'll just continue reading. We are on last para, 86, page 86.
We have a friend and that we have a friend that came in, Soma Majumdar. Did anybody?
I noticed that. I wanted to bring that up in the end. I noticed the name and the addition. Welcome, Soma.
Thank you so much. I'm absolutely enjoying listening to you all. Thank you for including me.
Sure. Welcome aboard, Jai Baba.
Thank you, Jai Baba.
Yeah. Soma has been our friend with Jimmy Modi's evening sessions. Reading Baba books from Bombay. So I had a chance to invite her. Baba made it possible and she agreed to join us. And we're so pleased to join, to have her.
Yes, it is. Welcome.
Yeah, now I remember. You guys shared a Jimmy Modi video and I remember her voice from that. Welcome, Soma. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, welcome.
Yeah. True spirituality is comprehensive. The things and the happenings of this earthly existence upon as... Yeah?
Karthik, you left two paragraphs in the previous page.
Did I?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, yes. One paragraph. Yeah. One paragraph. I finished this one. I finished up to indifference, right? So I have to start from 2C things, correct?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, apologies. 2C things as they are is to grasp their real significance as parts of the manifestation of the one life and to see through the veil of their apparent multiplicity is to be free from the insistent obsession for anything in its imagined isolation and exclusiveness. This is the heady line, so I'm going to read it again slowly. To see things as they are is to grasp their real significance as parts of the manifestation of the one life. And to see through the veil of their apparent multiplicity is to be free from the insistent obsession for anything in its imagined isolation and exclusiveness. I hope it's clear on the second read. The life of the spirit is to be found in comprehensiveness that is free from clinging and in appreciation that is free from entanglement. It is a life of positive freedom in which the spirit infuses itself into matter and shines through it without submitting to any curtailment of its own claims. This is a very, very, very important couple of things that are brought out here. So I'll just give it a moment for everybody to internalize it.
Yeah. Just, freedom from entanglement. Yeah. Appreciation free of entanglement.
Yeah. Yeah. And free from clinging, right? The life of the spirit is to be found in comprehensiveness that is free from clinging and in appreciation that is free from entanglement. It's a life of positive freedom in which the spirit infuses itself into matter and shines through
clinging, can we explain the clinging and entanglement? So clinging is self-creating attachment. And entanglement is by the force of environment, we are made to get attached to so many things in life. So can we take it like that? That's why clinging is self-created. That is binding that we create ourselves. Whereas entanglement is a part of the life in the environment where things are enforced on you. You get attached to them.
Yeah, I think Mamaji, it is it's just a different degree of thing. Clinging is just a mental thing, you know, and entanglement is getting involved even beyond, you know,
beyond that.
Physically involved, or I think it's this a degree of the same thing.
Same thing
for my easy understanding.
Yeah. See, clinging has got more, I think, using our choice, you know, at one point, let us say, we have a choice of either we should attach to that or not attach to that. We have a choice. At that point, let's say we chose to attach, that is clinging. Once you cling on to that, you get automatically attached to that. That is the small, very fine difference between those two things. Jai Baba.
Okay.
Anybody else?
I just want to add that whether it is clinging or whether it is entanglement, both are creating sanskaras.
Yeah, we create sanskaras irrespective of, you know, whatever it is. But clinging is, we have a choice. We are like not very strongly attached to that. We are at the entry point, you know, either we take a left turn or a right turn. We are at that junction. That is where we choose a choice of clinging there. Once you cling to that, when you continue to cling to that, you get attached to that. That's much more harder to get out of it. That's what I'm thinking. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, I think Ravi is correct. I think he's talking about the process of entanglement, which is the final aspect. Say, for example, I never smoked a cigarette, like, you know, and I tried because I want to experiment and see how it feels. So you have two choices. We know that cigarette smoking is injurious to your health, but I wanted to experience the feeling of smoking a cigarette and enjoying that experience of tobacco. So now the question is that suddenly our body says like, hey, why don't we smoke regularly? Like, you know, depending on the crowd or depending on your own sanskaras. But the big picture is it is avoidable to smoke. So if we go to the temptation of smoking, now we become an addict. We start smoking, we become a chain smoker, and we become entangled. Whereas right at the beginning, you experimented with it. You know that, hey, I feel like having, I would like to smoke more cigarettes. But the big picture is it's not healthy for me. So I have the choice of not doing it. So you're not clinging, nor you get entangled. So that's what I think Ravi is explaining. Jai Baba.
Yes, thank you for the explanation.
Thank you. So we'll continue. True spirituality is comprehensive. The things and the happenings of this earthly existence are looked upon as extraneous only until they are engulfed in the advancing tide of comprehensive spirituality. When once they find their right place in the scheme of life, each of them is seen to participate in the symphony of creation. Then spirituality does not require a separate or exclusive expression. It does not become degraded by being concerned with the ordinary physical, intellectual, and emotional needs of people. The life of the spirit is a unified and integral existence that does not admit of exclusive or unrelated compartments. divine love, a creative and dynamic response to environment. The life of the spirit is an unceasing manifestation of divine love and spiritual understanding, and both these aspects of divinity are unrestricted in their universality and unchallengeable in their inclusiveness. Thus, divine love does not require any special type of context for making itself felt. It need not await some rare moments for its expression, nor is it on the lookout for somber situations that savor of special sanctity. It discovers its expression in every incident and situation that might be passed over by an unenlightened person as too insignificant to deserve attention.
Jai Baba, Karthik, I think I have one suggestion. After you finish each reading of a paragraph, would you let the audience make a comment if they have something to say in terms of examples, case studies, or anything related with the seven realities or those 14 variables? So I think this last paragraph that you read, Divine Love, Creative and Dynamic Response to Environment, the subtitle, to me, the insight was, which I've been saying many times, self-awareness every waking moment, which means that everything that you do, right from the time you get up and start brushing your teeth, making your breakfast, if you're able to do it with complete self-awareness, it is a form of spirituality, the life of the spirit. Jai Baba.
Perfect. And to take up your point on the logistics, I if you've noticed, I pause at every para to allow for any interjection from anybody. So I'll continue to do that. But stopping and asking for after every para is kind of breaks the flow. But I do pause if you've noticed. Right, so I do pause longer than I normally used to.
Thanks for the clarification. So
please jump in. Yeah, please jump in. The others, please note, please jump in with your ideas and thoughts that need not wait for the next para. And try to link it back, as Kama said, to the variables, the themes, and the realities as often, as frequently as possible.
So
from divine love... yeah, sure.
I just want to add that the divine love can be related to the postulate on real love in the seven realities.
Yeah, exactly. That's
that is same.
Thank you.
That is both are same.
Yeah. So from divine love, we go to the paragraph. Ordinary human love is released only under suitable conditions. It is a response to certain types of situations and is relative to them. But divine love, which springs from the source within, is independent of stimuli. It is released, therefore, even in circumstances that would be looked upon as unfavorable by those who have tasted only human love. If there is lack of happiness or beauty or goodness in those by whom a perfect master is surrounded, these very things become for him the opportunity to shower his divine love on them and to redeem them from the state of material or spiritual poverty. His everyday responses to his worldly environment become expressions of dynamic and creative divinity, which spreads itself and spiritualizes everything he puts his mind to. The reference is to Perfect Master. Spiritual understanding.
Baba, I think Karthik here, I think the reference would be what we have spoken in Action in Action, when we talked about the conscious inaction or conscious active inaction of the Perfect Master.
Yes.
That we discussed from God's speech. Yes. Jai Baba.
Good. Perfect.
And that is also explained in the when we say that perfect masters or Sadgurus, the company of them itself is rewarding. That is, they are, say, pervading divinity and love to all those who come to them. So this is how they do it, I think. Hey, Baba.
Perfect.
Jai Baba, there is another example which I would like to point out. When in this paragraph you talked about ordinary human love is released only under suitable conditions, it is a response to certain types of situations and is relative to them. In one of the discursive chapter called Conditions of Happiness, page 396 to 397, Baba gives an example. If a man sees his own son wearing tattered clothes, he does all that he can to give him good clothes and is anxious to see him happy. Under these circumstances, he would consider his own feeling toward his son as that of pure love. But in his quick response to the distress of his son, the part played by the idea of mine is by no means inconsiderable. If he happened to see the son of some stranger on the street wearing tattered clothes, he would not respond as he had in the case of his own son. This shows that though he may not be fully conscious of it, his behavior toward his own son was in fact largely selfish. The feeling of mine is there in the background of the mind, though it can be brought to the surface only through searching analysis. It is a response. Self-awareness, very important here. If his response to the son of a stranger is the same as to his own son, then only can he be said to have pure and selfless love. So I think this is a very interesting example of the difference between ordinary human love and pure and selfless love. Jai Baba.
Brilliant cross-reference on selfless love and the nature of ordinary human love. I'll just make a quick note of it before I forget so that I can add it to this chapter.
I want to highlight selfless love is rare, actually. It's very, very few people have it. Jai Baba.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I'll go back in a minute. That's where we were, right? Yes. We were finishing the chapter, I mean, the para on ordinary human love. The subtitle is Spiritual Understanding Not Born of Blind Imitation. Spiritual understanding, which is the complementary aspect of the life of the spirit, must be distinguished from worldly wisdom, which is the quintessence of the conventions of the world. Spiritual wisdom does not consist in the unquestioning acceptance of the ways of the world. The ways of the world are almost always the collective effect of the actions of materially inclined people. Worldly people consider something to be right and make it right for persons of similar inclination. Therefore, the blind following of conventions does not necessarily secure wise action. The life of the spirit cannot be a life of uncritical imitation. It must have its basis in the true understanding of values. This is a remarkable chapter. It's just popping out in my mind from the time we started it. I believe that this should be the first chapter we should read, because that's what I felt, right? So it's a very beautiful chapter.
Jai Baba, one of the things I would like to comment is the chapter Infinity of the Truth, page 117 in 7th edition, is closely related to this chapter, The Life of the Spirit. So when we come to that, we can try to go back and see how they are correlated. That's also, I call it a very quantum physics type of chapter, the life of the infinity of the truth. Actually, I would call it SIT, spiritual infinity of the truth, SIT, you know. Jai Baba.
Spiritual infinity of the truth.
Okay.
All right. So we are closing this chapter just at the stroke of 9. So any other questions and comments before we wrap up for the day?
One more comment. I think the last line you read, it's probably almost like a 7 realities. The life of the spirit cannot be a life of uncritical imitation. It must have its basis on the true understanding of values. This true understanding of values is what I feel personally is the human challenge. What kind of value we give to each and every action that we do? Jai Baba.
And this is a recurring theme as well, right? Values and a true recognition of values or understanding adjustment. Of true values is adjustment. These are recurring themes in discourses as we have observed in both the readings. Yeah. Okay. So anything else?
Can we have a quick introduction of the new person who has joined?
Sure, of course. We can even see her if she's comfortable. And why don't you just quickly introduce yourself, Somaji?
Soma, turn on your video.
I will do that because I'm actually not
how
very,
you look like.
I'm not very well today, but tomorrow morning I will switch on my video just out with the cold. And I hope I'm all okay. So talking about myself, I live in Chennai and I'm a housewife. New to Baba, last 3 years. And well, first of all, it was a brilliant session. And I would be very happy if you would include me in your sessions. I think I would learn a lot about Baba. I love the analysis. I just loved listening. I don't know how this 1.5 years, half hours just passed by. There was so much to learn and so much to assimilate, and I loved all your interpretations.
So this is the same Soma we see in the Jimmy Modi's talks. Yes, yeah, I can recognize. Hope you can recognize me also.
Of course, Mamaji, I 100% recognize you. My voice may be sounding different because I have a cold, as I told you. Yes. So, nothing more to speak about myself. Just want to learn more and more about Baba, in awe and in love with Baba.
Okay, thank you.
Great.
Okay. Great. Welcome aboard and looking forward to seeing you on our sessions. There's nothing to join or nothing to be included. This is welcome, and I mean all are welcome to join these sessions. So meanwhile, I'll end with the note of seventh plane taking. Take it till you make it.
Kartika, I just want to make a comment.
Go ahead, Ravi.
You know, whenever I attend any of these Zoom sessions, especially from people participating in India, and whenever they have microphones open, the speakers open, you know, I see all these emergency vehicles going in there, and I see here beep, 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 beep sound. That depresses me a lot. It really pains me a lot. And my sister, we have a family meeting discourses every day, 5 days a week. My sister-in-law tells me that she closes her door because the moment she opens the door and she sees the bodies going out continuously, you know, these days. That makes me really cry the deep in my heart. Why, you know, so much of suffering, you know, the whole India is going through. Baba, when are you going to stop this? I think we all need to pray, and Baba will listen to us. We are Baba lovers, and his lovers are us, you know. Baba loves us. So when we ask him, he will do something. And he knows what we were going to ask. You must have already done it. So I think it is up to us to request him to slow down his manifestation so that people won't suffer so much. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba,
indeed. Yeah,
just want to add, can I just?
Sure. I
just want to add for the entire group that when we had started discourses last year, the first reading was on the chapter called The Travails of the New Order.
New World Order, sorry, I
missed that word. So I think we are all going through a transformation, a lot of loss of lives, very, very true, but and also it creates a lot of feelings because we are all human beings, and we have that. But yes, we all should pray. That's a valid suggestion. And at the same time, I would say that the redeeming. I'm an optimist, and I feel that the redeeming factor or fact is that Baba has said that after all this transformation, something eternal and something very happy will come out. So I would just say we have some happy thoughts. That's it. And of course, pray for all the souls who are getting merged with or who have gone on the journey in the next life, the next phase of their life. Jai Baba.
Both those messages were
very Jai Baba Ravi. So sorry, Kartik.
Hi, Sherry. How are you? Your voice sounds all right.
Very I am very to... good. Thank you so much. Oh, yes. Jai Baba. Yes. Everyone in my family is recovered. Although, yes, near ones and dear ones are still suffering, and people in the family are running around for oxygen and beds and ICU and ventilators. But again, maybe until I came to Baba, I was one of the person who was always complaining and crying and, you know, but today I would say not completely. I still go through that phase of complaining or crying, but much lesser comparatively. Because somewhere Baba has mentioned that sufferings and calamities are but a blessing in disguise in the spiritual path. So let us hold on to his Dhamman. Whatever he is planned and he is doing is for a reason. Just let us trust his doings. And may he give us that strength to accept it. Jai Baba. Welcome, Soma. It's so nice to see you.
Thank you,
Jai Baba, adding on to what Ravi and Ashok said and Sherry said, my insight towards what is happening, as Ashok said, the new humanity chapter and the travails of the new world order explains a lot of the things that are going on. Second thing is, I always remember, to me, one of the biggest aspect of Baba's life is the new life, started in 1949, October 15th, for 2.5 years, which we know was what you call as the phase of helplessness and hopelessness. And I think Baba did that so that we can take away from his own experience with the Mandali. So I think if people can read that part of Baba's life, it will help them to go through this particular time period. Third thing I want to say is, you know, when my mom had last stage cancer and she lived for about 3.5 months, I had the privilege of Mr. Mehernath from the Sampath Iyengar family. He's the grandson. Sampath Iyengar was one of the earliest devotees in the 1920s. There's a temple of silence in Chennai. In Saidapet, the Brahmin's thing, there's a website also. And he came to meet my mom. And Mehernath has played with Baba many times when he was a child and baby, because Baba celebrated 3 of his birthdays in Sampath Iyengar's household. And
it was very interesting, you know, because he used to live, because my mother was, in Chennai that time, in Adyar, and he was living about a kilometer away, and I would go meet him. And one day he said that, you know what, I want to come and see your mother, you know. And at that time he was about 85, and he had fallen down and he couldn't walk. And we were living on the second floor, you know. And I said, like, sir, you know, there is no need for you to come, you know, because I will take your blessings to my mom. But he insisted, like, you know, when somebody insists for more than three times, then I know that something is serious out here. So one day he came to our house and he walked up the stairs. And after some time, he went to my mother's room and we held her hand. And I was feeling very good because, you know, it was almost like Baba was holding my mother's hand, you know. And I had a picture of Baba with that phrase, real happiness lies in making other people happy, right where she was sleeping. You know, as she woke up, she would see that. And before he left a page. Mr. Mehernath used to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he used to write all the different, yeah. He had his own compilation of different subjects and topics. And he would compile that, he would cyclostyle, Xerox them and give it to people, you know. And that day he gave me a one-pager on a printer on both sides. And I read it after he left, and it was about suffering. And I will send it to you guys. And the one thing that hit me, I'll tell you quickly, it said that Baba said, I have many lovers, but I have some very special friends for whom I get special prasad. And he said that the special prasad is suffering. And one line that hit me was, suffering is a benediction. So if we can take that from that perspective, and another gentleman who's a Baba lover also told me, the more the obstacles, quicker the path. Jai Baba.
Amazing, amazing sharing. Thank you, Ravi. Thank you, Ashok. Thank you, Sherry. And of course, beautiful words, Kama. Do share the couple of pages. I know Mehernath, I met him as well, and I totally agree with him. I agree with your assessment. He's such a special person. And I recently discovered the audios of his messages, right? So basically the ones that he cyclostyled, a couple of Baba lovers from Chennai had made it audio files. So I'll get around to putting it up on Teams and sharing it with a group. I've been listening to those now. They're so special. Very nicely done audio files. So I'll share that as well. Thank you.
There is Soma.
On that note,
yes.
Let's pray to Baha'i. Hi, good to see you, Soma.
Hi.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai
Baba.
And let's catch up tomorrow. Jai Baba.
Yes.
Jai Baba.
Thank you.
Jai Baba, everyone. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.